The goal of this video is to provide a general overview of the PyOLDB Provider Schema and enable developers to teach themselves how to write PyOLDB Provider queries. As I'm sure a lot of you have been waiting for so far, we're going to finally start writing some queries. Let's start by opening up PySQL Commander Lite. The focus of this video is going to be on PyOLDB Provider, so let's start by connecting to our Py server from the PyOLDB Provider list. We're going to use the query compendium as well as documentation to go through the list of catalogs. The query compendium button is listed at the top toolbar. When you click it, the query compendium opens on the right. What we're going to be looking at right now is this set right here, PyOLDB Provider Queries. Let's expand it out, and we see that there's generally one SQL file per catalog listed on the left. So we have an archive statements, PyPoint database statements, and we have a PyArchive, PyPoint catalog on the left. One of the good things about PyOLDB Provider is that the schema is fairly self-explanatory. If you look at the catalog names, you see that there is a catalog called PyArchive. That has all of your archive values. PyBatch has all of your batch values. PyDS is your digital states, etc. For the things that are not self-explanatory or things you would like more information on, you can go to the documentation, which we found earlier by going to PyHome, OLDB, doc, and then opening up the PyOLDB Provider User Guide. In this user guide, we can scroll down and find a table reference. Under the table reference, each of the catalogs are listed as well as their description. For example, PyArchive catalog, this catalog represents PyArchive database. Tables in this catalog expose the archive data in various ways. We're not going to use the documentation anymore in this tutorial. Instead, we're going to use just the query compendium. So let's go back to SQL Commander. Let's double click on archivestatements.sql so we can open it up. We can just start running the first few and show that the results of the queries are showing what we might expect. As we follow along with archivestatements.sql, let's open up the PyArchive catalog and the Object Explorer on the left. We can look at the list of table names, and we can kind of start to understand what we might be doing with them. PyAVG, PyAverage, PyCalc, PyCalculated Value, PyComp, PyComp2, PyCompressed Values. This begins the interesting discussion of why some tables have a 2 at the end of them. The SQL Query Compendium comes in with the first two queries, which are PyComp and PyComp2. You can see that these are both different, and we can run them to see what their results are. First one is showing data for CDM 158. The second one is as well. Full description is listed here, and it shows that the PyComp table is a PySQL subsystem compatible table. The reason that we have PyComp, PyInterp, PyPoint, tables like that, is for backwards compatibility with existing queries using the PyODBC client, and PySQL subsystem as the query engine. All queries moving forward using PyODB provider should use the two tables. They should never use PyComp or PyInterp directly, but should use PyComp2 or PyInterp2. To demonstrate the danger of using these tables, let's run this query, and then let's just put a 2 at the end and see what happens. Notice right now, all the values are the digital state values. When we execute this query, all the values have changed to good. That's because the way that the statuses are in PyComp2 is different than in PyComp. This is just one of many dangers you can run into if you use the PyComp or PyInterp tables in any queries moving forward. As we go through the query compendium, we can look at some different tables that are being used, as well as some general query syntaxes. For example, we can run this query. The next thing I want to show is the difference between using performance equations and expressions versus in the select statement. So let's query the PyCalc table. Let's do that by right-clicking on it and doing Execute Predefined Query. The input for PyCalc is an expression, so something like sinusoid. But the expression is a performance equation syntax, so sinusoid has to have single quotes around it. But that does mean that we can do things such as round. Of sinusoid. We execute this, we'll see that our values have now been rounded, and the expression has changed to round sinusoid. Another way that we could have done this is to use the round function in the select statement and to not use the PyCalc table at all. I've casted the value of sinusoid as a float 32 prior to rounding it because the round function does not know how to round a variant, and the pyinterpret2 table returns values as variants. So let's run this and show that it returns the same results. This one as well returns 1 and 3 for the rounded values. The expression portion of the PyCalc table allows performance equation syntax, as does any select statement. Therefore, there are a number of different ways that you can have the same output, but will have different query syntaxes. One thing to note is performance. So if we run this query, notice that it took 0.0110 seconds. If we run this query, notice that it took 0.0104 seconds. These are virtually identical, but as we scale out, you can notice there's a difference between different methods. Always be conscious of ways that you can approach the usage of functions, either using function-style tables such as PyCalc, or using functions directly in the select statement. If you're concerned about performance, just do the query multiple ways and check the execution time of each one. That'll be the best way to determine which is the best way to do it. One last note on this specific topic would be that in addition to any of these functions that are available in the select statement or in any of these tables that are built into the PyArchive catalog, there's also custom functions that can be built from the function catalog. So let's go to the PyLDB provider installation folder, tools, function catalog manager. Right-click on this, run as administrator, and connect to the Py server. All of these different functions can be implemented on demand. To do so, find the one that you would like to use. In this case, let's use the float32 version of round, and select it and create selected. Click OK, created one function view. Once created, the view will appear under the PyFunction catalog under Views. The next thing I'd like to show is the digital state catalog. Let's start with a new query window. And let's get the interpolated values of a digital state tag, such as CDM158. Notice the value is -196610. This doesn't mean anything inherently, but it's a way of representing a specific unique digital state among all digital sets. So let's go down to the IDS catalog, open up tables, and we'll see that every single table in here is a new digital state set. This will match what you see in Py System Management Tools if you were to look at your digital state sets. CDM158 is using modes. So let's right-click on Modes and execute Predefined Query. We noticed before the value -196610, and we see that value here as well. So if we would like to view the string name cascade instead of the code, we would have to join these tables. So let's do that now. I fully qualified the select statement to make sure that I got just the name from the modes table and everything else from the interpolated table. So let's execute this, and we see that instead of the code, we now see the string, manual, and program. This can be a little bit cumbersome though, as you need to know the exact name of the digital state set that is being configured for your tag. You also would not be able to easily join multiple digital state sets. So instead of doing it this way, let's go back to our original query, and let's fully qualify the select statement. And change the tag to CDM158. Instead of the value, let's put in digstring cast value is int32. Notice that digstring has produced the values as strings. Digstring is a very useful built-in function that switches the int32 codes for all the digital state sets and digital states and switches them into their string representation. The next thing I'll go over is write functionality with the PyLDB provider. If you'll remember from previous videos, PyLDB provider is read-write, whereas the other query engines are read-only. Let's return to the query compendium, archive statements, and let's start by querying all the values from today for sinusoid. Let's now run this query, which inserts a value into PyConf2 at today plus 8 hours, which is 8 a.m., a value of 1. One row affected. Now let's refresh this query, and we should see something at 8 a.m. with a value of 1. Next, let's delete this value so it no longer exists. And refresh the query. And notice our 8 a.m. value is now gone. There's a lot of write functionality within the PyLDB provider, and I highly encourage you to go through the query compendium and the documentation in more detail to figure out exactly what you can do with the PyLDB provider. Next thing I'd like to go over is the PyPoint database query compendium. Let's run this first query and see that it returns just the tags that have point source R. These are your 5 built-in standard tags. What we could do with this is join it with any of the PyArchive catalog tables so that we can get the archive data for entire groups of tags at one time. Let's do this now with our snapshot table. And let's join it the query that we just wrote. Let's run this query and see that we get the current values of 5 different tags, all based off of their point source. This is the most basic functionality of the PyPoint catalog. However, this catalog does have more tables in it, including base, classic, SQC, and totalizer tags. This catalog also benefits from the read-write functionality. Aside from these catalogs, the two most important catalogs that we have not talked about yet would be PyBatch and PyModule. These two catalogs expose the module database and the PyBatch database. For the purpose of time, I'm not going to go into detail about these catalogs. However, the query compendium does have a module database statements.sql file, as well as a batch database statements.sql file that goes through a lot of different options that you have when querying either of these two catalogs. I strongly encourage you to investigate these queries and these catalogs against your own system if you plan to write PyBatch or PyModule database queries. This concludes the video, and I hope it provided a good general overview of the PyLDB provider schema, and you are now better equipped to write your own PyLDB provider queries. Thank you.